Well, John Michener is our next speaker. He's been active in defense of the preborn since 2006. He's spoken at schools, churches, community organizations. He's an ordained minister. He's the president of the Oklahoma Conservative PAC, which I spoke at their banquet and a bunch of other things he had me speak at. He ran me ragged when I was there about a year ago. Been traveled for a year and a half all over on that book, The Doctrine of Lesser Magistrate. You know, now that Trump's won, yeah. Hillary would have won, I'd been a millionaire. Trump won, yeah, sales. Woo! Right down. People are still wed to their federal paradigm. They got to get broken out of that. And
Hey, man, I'm still buying your books.
So I met tons of people along the way. And you know how certain people stand out in your mind? John Michener is one of those people. You just love the guy. I love being around him. I like spending time with him. He's well-spoken. He loves the Lord. I just think it's great that we have him up here in Milwaukee. So if you give him a warm welcome, I appreciate it.
Yeah. I'm really thrilled that you introduced me correctly. The name's John Michener. Sometimes people mistake me for Dave Grohl, and they introduce me as Dave Grohl from the Foo Fighters. I am not with the Foo Fighters. I'm with the Faux Fighters. We're fighting falsehood. We're fighting for the truth. So Jason did a great job of talking about the forest, the big picture of what's going on in the pro-life movement. And now what I want to do is dive down into the forest, pick out a pretty little tree, me and some people I know, and we're going to decorate it for you with some details to illustrate the points that he's been making. And of course, you know, it's better to see something for yourself than for me to tell it to you. And so I hope not to tell you what to think tonight. I hope to just show you what I've experienced, and then you can take whatever you get from that through the Holy Spirit. I am the director of an organization called Oklahomans United for Life. Now, that may sound like a real pro-lifey kind of organized super organization for pro-life everything that we're against, right? But that's for a reason, because we're different. But you need to speak the language sometimes of another group before they can hear you. But if I can show up and say, I'm with Oklahomans United for Life, and I represent these many thousands of people, and this is the kind of policy that we're interested in, they're at least going to listen. We needed an organization like that in our state to go head-to-head with organizations like Oklahomans for Life that had a completely different message. And I'll show you some of that that's going on. So I'm going to talk to you about my spiritual journey. It's a journey for everyone. We're all working out our salvation with fear and trembling, and we're at different places along the way. And as Pastor Matt said, we continue to repent as the Lord shows us new things from which we need to repent. Sometimes we don't even realize that we're part of the problem. We're just naively going along, following the path of least resistance as water goes downhill, not realizing that many times those paths are carved out strategically by powerful evil forces. And we just go right down that same path when we need to be going someplace else. So one of the things that happened to me a couple of years ago that brought some things to my attention was, we've got this political pack in Oklahoma. It's called the Oklahoma Conservative PAC. This is the logo up here. It's been around for going on 26 years now. And so they've got a mission. They want to promote public servants. When I say public servants, think magistrates. That's legislators, executives in the state, elected and appointed. Well, we support them, the ones who oppose expansive government while promoting free markets and liberty based on Judeo-Christian values. So obviously, this is the kind of thing that we would all want to be involved in. And I had been for years. In fact, I was a vice president hanging out at the weekly meetings, going, rah, rah, go Republicans, and all this kind of stuff. Well, what happened is the guy who founded this organization decided to retire in 2015. And I didn't know it, but I was the heir apparent. So I find myself now the president of this PAC. Now, what comes along with that is a change in your mind, because now I'm no longer sitting in the seat listening and absorbing what the leader's saying. Now I am the leader and people are wanting to absorb what I say, and now I have to pay attention. So it puts a little pressure on you. And so things begin to change, obviously. So that's why I got involved with this group, and it really helped me to expand my mission and the things that I wanted to talk about with Oklahomans United for Life. Now, the way this PAC accomplishes its mission is by finding good candidates, then supporting the candidates through financial contributions and door knocking and that kind of thing. We educate the state on principles of good government. That means I'm doing a weekly update. So 50, how many weeks in a year? 52? Yeah, my wife says yes. 52 times a year, I'm sending out an update, and those updates are always based on these godly principles, right? We don't just say, here's the policy, or here's the thing that we have to oppose, or the person we have to support, but we say, why? Why? Because it's wrong to kill people and steal their stuff, because it's wrong to covet, because collectivism is not right. You can't protect the community without protecting individuals first. Yeah. So these are the principles that we pound over and over and over every week, trying to educate our elected officials and that grassroots in the state, that 1%. Finally, and here's where I want to focus for a few minutes, we try and hold these guys accountable with the conservative index. For 38 years, the conservative index in our state, which is published by the Oklahoma Constitution newspaper, is the measuring stick for legislators in Oklahoma, Senate and House, both sides. We look at a number of issues each year. Here's some examples, not everything, but just some examples of what we're judging these guys on. How are they voting in the halls of the Senate and the House when it comes to proper function of government, property rights, free markets? Are they increasing taxes? Are they borrowing money? Are they doing things that protect liberty and religious freedom? What about state sovereignty? We're supposed to be a sovereign state that voluntarily joined a union of states. But practically, we function like the federal jurisdiction of Oklahoma. I don't even know why we have a capital anymore. So we take a look at things as it pertains to state sovereignty and if they're upholding that or not. Self-defense, gun rights. So all these things, right, we're looking at and we're measuring them. Were you really following God's way or were you following man's way? And of course, what do you think is a key part of that index every year? Abortion. Yes, life. Right? So that's at least 10% every year of that grade. And so here I am now leading the process that grades the legislators for the last few years. And I've not been in this position before. So what happens? I take over in the spring of 2015. And now instead of sitting where you're sitting, waiting for these guys up here to tell me what's going on, I'm having to look at it for myself. What are the actual bills they're running? What do they say and what would they do? I want to take you on a little four-year journey of mine through this process and see what I learned along the way. I'm going to start back in 2014 because at that time I was still sitting in the audience. I was the vice president who occasionally got up and led the meeting when the man was out of town. And so I'm not really paying attention. Well, in 2014, we had a Senate bill, 1848. It was passed. When I say passed, that means everyone in the Senate voted for it, majority. Everyone in the House voted for it, majority. So there's 48 in the Senate. There's 101 in the House. So a lot of people are voting for this across the state. And then the governor signs it. That means it's supposed to go into law. So that's what I say when it gets passed. So it passes, and then we use it. We, meaning our PAC, uses it on our conservative index, saying that the guys who voted for it are pro-life. Now, this law did what? It required physicians performing abortions in Oklahoma to have admitting privileges at a hospital within 30 miles of a hospital, of a clinic. Well, why do you think we did this? We did it because Texas did it. Because we follow each other. We go, what's going on? Who's doing what? Oh, we haven't tried that one yet. Let's go try that one. So Texas tried it. It looked like it was going to work. So we wanted to get some gimmick that would work too, and we did it. Only problem is we have an uber progressive court in Oklahoma that's worse than the federal Supreme Court, and nothing ever actually goes into effect. I didn't understand any of this back in 2014. I'm like, yay, we passed something that might do some good. Of course, it was challenged, and it never went into effect. But it was on our index. I was in the audience. I voted, yes, that's the bill we should use. So let's go forward to 2015. Now I'm the president, but I just became the president. I've got to change this because we have elections in the spring right in the middle of a legislative session. So I go from not paying attention to having to pay attention in the middle of a session with bills already being heard and voted on. But right in the middle of that session, we get this House bill, and it was passed, and we used it on our conservative index. But let me set the context for you. First of all, what the bill was supposed to do, it was supposed to ban dismemberment abortion. So here we are, I'm in charge of the process, and I'm going, well, what pro-life bills are there? Let me go and see. I find this pro-life bill because everyone's talking about it. And I read the bill, and I'm scratching my head because it seems like a really bad idea. When you dive right into it, the language of the bill says that you cannot kill an unborn child by pulling him out of the womb using this dismemberment abortion procedure. Now, I've been in contract administration before. I know what words mean. And I understand that, well, shoot, as long as the doctor kills the baby in the womb, then he can go ahead and rip it out anyway and do the very same procedure. So even if this goes into effect, it's not going to save a single life. I had enough sense to read the bill and figure that out in the spring of 2015. And I even actually brought it to our PAC and explained it and exposed it. And then a few months go by, and now it's time to do the conservative index, but it's the only pro-life bill we've got, and what do? I just do the same thing we've always done, right? It's the pro-life bill. It would have banned dismemberment abortion. It's not going to go into effect anyway, but we've got to give them a grade. So we put the bill on there. Now, I grew up in a church. I was baptized when I was 10 years old. I don't have a testimony of coming off the streets and getting punched in the face and having crooked teeth like Matt and all this stuff. Truth be known, I didn't know any sinners growing up. Right? Yeah, we had our one token alcoholic in the congregation. It was a while before I kind of realized what sin really is and how insidious it is and can get into you. Pride is the worst one there is, friends and neighbors, and we all got it, and we all got it bad. Okay, but my point is we tend to just absorb the culture around us, and even though the light bulbs may go off, we don't immediately connect all the dots. The light doesn't immediately say, go get that cobweb out of that corner over yonder. The light's on now, but it takes a while to go around and clean up the house. So I'm in charge, I saw this bill, I knew it was a problem, but we still put it on our index. But I'm learning. I'm not going to keep repeating the same mistakes. So now I want to take you up to 2016, obviously. What have I learned so far? I had a year of sitting in the seat, then I had a year in the driver's seat, and right away I started seeing that, whoa, there's a moral problem here. And Jason explained that very well, the moral problem, so I don't have to go into this. I realized that accepting incrementalism actually does condone murder, so that was a problem I learned through this process. What really brought the light bulb home for me is when I considered the rape analogy. For me, it's very helpful to always change the terms to see if the moral principle still applies. And I started asking people, hey, how would we act if the Supreme Court had found a right to privacy to rape little girls? And what if we had these rape clinics set up in all our major metro areas where you could go abuse young women privately, safely, in these clinics? Supreme Court found it. Supreme Court ruled. What are you going to do? Would we be sitting around saying, yeah, go ahead and rape those girls, the Supreme Court said? Or how about we regulate that? Why don't we ban rape just on Friday nights between 5 and 7 p.m. because, you know, Friday nights is a high-volume night. Let's just kind of pick away right there on rape. We wouldn't go for that, would we?
No.
But all of a sudden, it gets really clear. And that's what happened for me when I started plugging in different issues like that. I saw the clarity of the moral issue. I realized, looking back, that back in 2014, when we used that, you know, 30 miles near a hospital thing, we were saying that it's okay to murder somebody as long as it's near a hospital. And all of a sudden, my head was exploding. How can we be doing this? It also taught me the tactical problem as I looked back. Besides the moral issue, I saw what they were doing to us with the tactics. You know, we've agreed to play an evil game with very diabolical rules.
Yeah.
We're on Satan's territory. That's exactly right. These bills, they know they're going to get tied up in the court.
Yep.
They know they're going to go into the court. Nothing's even going to go into effect. So forget the moral principle. They're not even going to do anything with the approach we're using right now. So nothing is going to change. Then when I looked at the year before, I realized that that was another illustration of the tactical problem. I remembered, oh, I read that bill. I knew it wasn't going to do anything. It's going to protect no one. So here I am playing their game again. And that's what I learned. We're left with the nibblings. We want something real. We want something nourishing. We want the truth. We want good food, and we get the scraps fit for the trash. And so I just wanted to illustrate what Jason was explaining earlier about how this game is played. And he talked about how, oh, you give him money. No, you give him money. And it goes round and round. This is how we show that cozy arrangement. We've got this wonderful little old lady with her kitty in her lap. Well, that little kitty in her lap is the pro-life lobbyist, the one that takes the bill up to the Capitol and says, you know what, you shouldn't be able to kill kids with pliers just every other way, right? And then the little old lady says, oh, we're going to run with that because that's the GOP establishment. And back and forth they goes. The kitty comes and purrs. The GOP strokes the kitty. And everybody says everybody's pro-life. And it goes round and round and you get the scraps. So this is what I learned. We've covered 2 years. We've covered what I've learned. Now let's see the changes that are starting to take place. I really do think that that what we sometimes negatively refer to as the pro-life movement can be reclaimed. There have been great awakenings. There have been restorations. There have been reformations. And we are going to take this movement back to where pro-life, I hope one day again, will also mean that we are completely, absolutely against abortion, because they don't say that, the majority of them these days. But also think about why they don't, because so many of them are like me, sitting in the pew, sitting in the audience, not knowing any different, not knowing any better, until some light is shined, till some catalyst comes in, till some word comes in to set me on a different path. So in 2016, we're going through this process again, of course, and we had this conference like this we had in Oklahoma, and at that time, we tried to do something different. So last year, the pro-life establishment, the Kitty Cat, ran this bill called the Humanity of the Unborn Child Act, and it was pushed and passed by the establishment pro-life lobby, and it created this media campaign, although it didn't fund it because we had a budget shortfall because we're always borrowing money. But supposedly, there's this campaign that's going to teach that abortion kills a living human being. What a joke. Guess what? We did not use it on the index. We didn't fall for the trap again. So we learned something. Tuesday night, if you all can come back in the snow, I want to talk about some more of the details that we are working on. And now here we are in 2017. This year, there are still some bad, quote, pro-life bills in our legislature. One that they're running this year is the Prenatal Non-Discrimination Act, which is being pushed by the lobby again, and it says that unborn babies may not be murdered because they're handicapped. Because they're handicapped. But you can kill all the rest of them. So not only are we not going to use this bill this year, but we're actually exposing it and attacking it and have plans to turn it into something that could really be used for good. And we hope that that works out. All right, let's see. I think I'm ready to summarize the moral and the tactical problems, right? Incrementalism actually means you're condoning murder. Bills get tied up in court. Nothing actually changes. Legislators believe the lies, and they follow the rigged rules of an evil game. That is what's happening. So I want to talk for just a few minutes about what these lies are that the legislators believe. And again, remember, there are truly evil legislators and magistrates out there. They have been possessed. They have chosen to be hardened and been hardened. And you can almost see that some of them are demon-possessed. But again, remember, many of them are well-meaning people, just like I was, sitting there kind of in a passive role. For whatever reason, they got themselves elected. They won the beauty contest. They put on the right tie, they had enough money, and voila, they're elected. But it doesn't mean that they automatically know what they're supposed to do. Keep that in mind with these guys. But here are some of the lies that they either perpetuate for selfish, evil reasons, or they just believe because that's the water they swim in. Here are some of those lies. First, they think that abortion is constitutional. Yes, yes. Because they think that constitutional equals court opinions. Just about 2.5 weeks ago, I was in a legislator's office asking her to support our resolution that I'll talk about on Tuesday night. And I explained what it would do and why it was principled and good. And she said, "That sounds great. That sounds like something I would be for. But isn't that unconstitutional?" And so then I had to explain to her what her job was and how to do it. Don't be surprised when you have to do that. They also believe the lie that officials are subject to the court. Therefore, the battles have to be fought in the court. They have no concept of jurisdiction, of warring jurisdictions, and that you might have to actually fight against the court. So they're just waiting around for the justices to change their minds, because they're the final arbiters. So let me show you why that lie, particular lie, is just a bunch of junk. These next few slides come from Bradley Pierce, an abolitionist attorney in Texas. He shared these at a conference just a few weeks ago. But there's this lie that, you know, if we would just appoint or just elect Republican presidents, they would appoint pro-life Republican justices, and we could actually undo Roe v. Wade, and the problem would be solved. Well, here's what we've got. We've had 48 years of presidents since Roe v. Wade, 28 years of Republicans, 20 years of Democrats. Now, here's the makeup of the court in 1972 and 1973 when Roe v. Wade was heard, and then the opinion came out early in 73. As you can see, four of those justices were appointed by Nixon. In fact, you've got seven Republican appointees and only, six versus three Democrat appointees. So 1973, the ruling comes down, and you've got five, six, seven of them. Seven said abortion is a woman's right. And you'll notice that five of them were appointed by Republicans, only two dissenting against abortion. Now, we're going to go forward in time. We're going to run through the years and watch what happens to the court. Ford comes to power. He replaces a justice. Reagan replaces three justices. Bush replaces two justices. We're now in 1992. And if you're not colorblind, you can look up there and see that the court is stacked 8-1 in favor of pro-life Republican appointed justices in 1992. And we now have an opportunity to undo Roe v. Wade from 1972 because we have a new case before the court. It's Casey versus Planned Parenthood. Yep. Now let's look at the makeup of the court. Who's left on this court from 73? Here's who's left. Blackmun is the only one left from 73 who voted for abortion and two left who voted against it. You have six new justices, all appointed by pro-life Republican presidents. So we're going to overturn Roe v. Wade in 1992, and what happens? Five of them vote to uphold abortion, only four against. All five appointed by Republican presidents. And they make matters worse. In 1973, the court said a woman has a right to an abortion, but states may regulate it. In 1992, they add to that, states may not put a significant hindrance or obstacle in the way of a woman wanting an abortion. So ever since 1992, everything states try to do to regulate abortion immediately gets thrown out because it's an obstacle. They made it worse. This is what pro-life Republican presidents have done for us. That's the number one lie. The lie that we have to elect this president, he'll appoint the justices, and they'll overturn Roe. By the way, even if they did overturn Roe, that would send it back to the states, yeah, and they would still have to grow a backbone and deal with it. So why not just bypass this whole step altogether?
Yeah, amen.
Other lies that we believe and that these magistrates believe. They think, and they've been told, that we have to be patient. There's this lie that, oh, well, we didn't get here overnight. We incrementally got worse and worse, so we're going to have to incrementally get better and better. We have to be patient. We have to take baby steps. I'm baby stepping back, right? That's what they think. So they want us to be patient. And then they'll make the argument, you know what? We have to change the culture. If we change enough people's minds, then public policy follows the people. So we have to do enough evangelizing, we have to do enough grassroots activity, we have to have all these conferences, we have to have everybody in agreement first that abortion is murder before we can stop it, change the culture. That's the other thing, the other lies that they believe. What is the truth? What is the truth in all of this? The truth, of course, is that abortion is unconstitutional. Read the Fifth Amendment to the Constitution. It's in black and white. It's a straight-up unconstitutional deal. What's lawful? Not court opinion. What's lawful is what the Constitution says, if it's in accordance with God's word. And magistrates are not subject to the courts. They're subject to God. That's where their authority comes from, and it's upon his law that all civil law must be based, or it has no validity. So therefore, the fight should take place outside the court, against the court. I'll be done in 5 minutes. Therefore, officials should defy the court and insist on abolition as the only legal option. More truth. Think about Josiah, King Josiah, 2 Kings chapters 22 and 23. You should read this tonight. Make a note to yourself. What was his approach? He came to power at a time when his people were sacrificing to strange gods and sacrificing their children to Molech right outside Jerusalem. And how did he deal with that problem? Did he wait to gain a majority? Did he take votes? Did he raise money and start social clubs to say idolatry and child sacrifice is bad? He didn't wait for the culture to change. He changed the culture. He pulled out the law, called the people to listen, read the law, and says, tomorrow we're enforcing the law. He didn't pursue gradual baby steps. He changed the culture. The time for justice is always right now.
Amen.
So in conclusion, wrapping it up, summarizing. Be gracious to people who were like me a few years ago. They don't know any better. And even when I knew better, I didn't immediately know how to get all the steps put in the right place. So be preaching, be teaching, be nagging, yes, but be gracious when you do that. We have been naive, believing the lies, and that sometimes makes us guilty. In contrast, what Jesus said was, don't be naive, be shrewd. Be seriously, wisely, intelligent, and sneakily good. Be shrewd and innocent as doves. Sneakily, that's right. No more playing the enemy's game, right? Don't just keep passing this stuff knowing that you'll get thrown in the trash. Our attitude should not be play within the courts. It should be play against the court. Ignore the court. Defy the court. We need to return to a battle of jurisdictions.
Yep.
That's where we've got to get. And that's what this week, that's what Joshua Glover, that's what 1859, the abolition of slavery, was all about.
Yep.
Righteous, right jurisdiction, bring on the battle. And that's actually my concluding remark, is that we need to hasten the real conflict. I thank God for this prophetic body here that's willing to accept that mission. Matt.
Amen.
Amen.